Okay, let me just start.
In Ireland, they put the question to the people, should same-sex couples have the right to get married? Tonight, the results of the referendum are in, and their answer is a resounding yes. NBC's Bill Neely has that story from Dublin.
They are celebrating a world first. Never before has a country's voters made same-sex marriage the law. Ireland did it decisively.
This is a decent, civilized, tolerant country. This is the way to go in the 21st century.
Every area but one voted yes. Proof Ireland has changed from being a deeply conservative country.
We're New Ireland and we're so proud to be Irish today.
The vote was 2-1 in favour of changing Ireland's constitution. A social revolution, say the winners.
This result, which would have been unimaginable here 2 decades ago, is a milestone for Ireland and a message that other countries, including the Vatican, will take note of.
The Catholic Church opposed the move. One archbishop says it now needs to do a reality check. But not everyone was in step. For many, this vote doesn't change traditional values.
I think every child should have a father and a mother.
The No campaign claim redefining marriage puts children at risk.
When you start telling them that gender doesn't matter, male, female doesn't matter, fathers and mothers don't matter, I mean, that's something that's going to be inculcated in children.
That's a view many researchers and a majority of Irish voters don't share. But even traditional Ireland decided it's time for change. In a country where homosexuality was still illegal in the early 1990s.
We are a small nation with a huge heart, which today shines brightly across the world.
And the party has begun here, after a vote that will resound far beyond their shores. Bill Neely, NBC News, Dublin, Ireland.
Well, that was how NBC News reported the Irish referendum on the day of the count on the 23rd of May. 2015. And as you can see, we had a big party. We're a country that knows how to party. I've been at a lot of those parties, and many of them break out into the streets. I remember when Ireland beat Italy in the World Cup. I remember when our rugby team beat England, and it's always extra sweet when we beat England, in our most hallowed sports hall. I remember many political celebrations. National Days, St. Patrick's Day on Fifth Avenue in New York. But I can tell you, I have never experienced a party like the party atmosphere that we had in Dublin on the 23rd of May 2015. And those of us who had the privilege of being part of the campaign were, of course, as they say, we didn't have to put our hand in our pocket all night. And there were many different events around the city. And I remember going to one of them, in the Clarence Hotel. Clarence Hotel, incidentally, is owned by the rock group U2, but that's just incidental. And there was a party in the Clarence Hotel, and I remember a young woman getting up on a chair, and she said some very nice words about the role that I played in the referendum campaign. And she said she had a little gift for me. And she handed me a faded one-page document, which was a copy of a press release from 1977, which I had issued when I was president of the Union of Students in Ireland. And the press release was very short, but it said something along the following lines, that it was time that Ireland started to talk about the fact that homosexuality was a criminal offense. I called on the government in it to set up a working group to have some discussion about this, and I made some just general remarks about equality. I had no recollection of issuing the press release. But what it did do was it reminded me that was 40 years beforehand, and that it took all of that 40 years, probably longer, to get to the point where we were on the 23rd of May, 2015. And it also reminded me that, in a way, I had spent my entire adult life campaigning for various forms of social change in my country. And it made me reflect on the extent to which my country had changed from being a deeply conservative, Catholic-dominated in terms of social policy country to one which had now become the first country in the world to approve same-sex marriage by popular vote. So how did that happen? And that's really what I want to talk about this evening. How did that big transition happen? Well, we go back to the beginning, 1921, when we got our independence, and as you can see, the country is divided, the Northern Ireland and the yellow bit in the corner is part of the United Kingdom. Country was partitioned at that time. Northern Ireland, 60% Protestant, 40% Catholic at that stage. And the southern state, which was then called the Irish Free State, which became independent, was 95% Catholic. So it was no surprise that the Catholic Church dominated social policy in the country right from the very beginning. They controlled, to a large extent, the schools, the hospitals. Their influence was seen in areas like censorship. One of the first things that the new government did in the 1920s was it set up a Committee on Evil Literature. There followed several decades of censorship of books, of movies, of thinking. Most of our best writers, and we produced a lot of them, were banned at one stage or another, their works. Some of great international writers, Catcher in the Rye, for example, by J.D. Salinger, was banned. Movies, Ulysses, the movie, was banned in 1967. Interestingly enough, the book was never banned, the book Ulysses, and that was because it wasn't actually being distributed in the country. No importer would take it in. No book distributor would put it on the shelves for many years. So it didn't. The official banning of it didn't really arise. And it wasn't. A lot of this continued until quite recent times. The Monty Python movies. Monty Python's Life of Brian, for example, was banned because it was deemed to be somewhat. Somewhat wrong. So there was a domination of all aspects of social policy by the Catholic Church, and there was a lot of state deference to the Church. Leading politicians, for example, they meet a bishop, meet the leading figures of the Church, the bishop puts out his hand, they genuflect, they kiss his ring. This went on for decades. Let me say that it wasn't all bad. I don't want this to, you know, I'm very proud, I'm very always very thankful of the very good education that I got from the priests that taught me in second level schools. And I still meet many people in Ireland who wish that the nuns were still running the hospitals. All of this was kind of formalized in 1937 in our constitution. Very good constitution, even though it had its origins, a lot of its origins in the thinking, some of the thinking of the 1930s. But that enshrined what was called the special position of the Catholic Church. Those weren't actually the words that were used in the Constitution, but that was the concept, that the Catholic Church was given a special position in the Constitution and in the country, was eventually deleted in 1972. Women were highly praised in the 1937 Constitution, but it made it very clear that women's place was in the home, which meant that, for example, equal pay didn't become a reality until 1976, and then on foot of a European Union directive, the same with legislation on equality to work. And married women in the public service, when they married, had to resign their position on marriage. The married women were not allowed to work in the public service. When I was a trade union official, before I was a politician, I used to represent the musicians in our national orchestra. And I remember one of the musicians, she was a violin player. She was coming close to retirement, and she came to me with a problem. And that was that she was only entitled to half a pension. And the reason was that in the 1950s, when she was playing in the orchestra, she married another musician in the orchestra. And she had to resign her permanent job. But of course, good violin players were hard to come by in the 1950s. So they decided, yes, you resign your job, you stop being a full-time employee, but you continue all the time on a part-time or a contract basis. And she continued right through. She never missed a day. She continued right through working for the National Symphony Orchestra, rejoined it on a full-time basis when the marriage bar was lifted, But by the time she was due to come to retirement, of course, her pension entitlement was halved because she was missing about 20 years full-time employment. The 1937 Constitution prohibited divorce, and although contraception wasn't included in the Constitution, it was, in line with that thinking, it was also illegal for a very long time. There was a lot of resistance to that, people trying to get change, but it really, that didn't crystallize until probably late 60s, early 70s, and there developed what became known as the liberal agenda. Now, back when this started, nobody started out with, here's the liberal agenda. A lot of this was ad hoc campaigning for particular changes, which developed over a period of time into what became known as the liberal agenda. But if it had been listed as an agenda at that time, this is what it would have looked like. Top of the list, equality for women, the legalization of contraception, the ending of the ban on divorce, rights for LGBTI people, and abortion. There were other issues, but those, in the main, were what was called the liberal agenda. There was no actual formal leader of the liberal agenda, but if there were, this woman is probably the leader of the liberal, the leading figure of the pursuit of that liberal agenda over that period of time. Mary Robinson, she was elected to the Senate in 1969 in her mid-20s. She was one of the first legislators to propose changes in laws on contraception and divorce. She was also a lawyer who took many of these issues to our own courts, to our own Supreme Court, and ultimately to the European Court of Human Rights, winning a number of them quite a significant cases. She was our first woman president. She was elected president in 1970. I had the honor of being one of the parliamentarians who signed her nomination papers, and I was a member of her campaign committee in 1990. In many ways, her election in 1990 marked a turning point in this transition because it was a signal that the country wanted identified with somebody who was a liberal thinker, who was campaigning on these issues, and who wanted to move the country forward. And as, of course, many of you know, she later became the United Nations Human Rights Commissioner and has served in a number of roles, in a number of United Nations roles, including representing, most recently, on climate justice as the Secretary General's representative on climate justice. She wasn't alone. I think it's fair to say that most of the early campaigners for these changes were women. And this is a photograph from 1970 of a group of women who were in the Irish Women's Liberation Movement. They mounted an interesting protest. This is 1970. As I said, the contraception was not available. It was illegal to import or to sell contraceptives in the country. And like, I suppose, every country or every people who are faced with, you know, repressive laws, you try and find ways around them. And this group of women said, okay, it's illegal to import contraceptives. But contraceptives are available for sale in Northern Ireland. And Belfast is only a two-hour train journey from Dublin. So they took the train to Belfast one Saturday. They bought lots of contraceptives. They returned on the train, and they demonstrated the contraceptives to the police and to the customs officials at the train station when they came back to Dublin. And the police and customs officials, who were mainly young men, as it turned out, were too embarrassed or identified maybe with the cause, and decided they weren't going to do anything about it. So de facto, the importation of contraceptives became a fact of life. As I said, it was illegal to import or sell contraceptives. So the way around this was, it was just illegal to sell them. There was no law that says you couldn't give them away for nothing. So what happened was these family planning clinics started to be set up, and these were places where you go, you get your contraceptives, you don't actually buy them, but you make a donation to the Family Planning Association, and okay, the donation happens to coincidentally amount to the price of the packet of condoms or whatever, but that was the way we found out. And a lot of this was pioneered in student unions. And I was involved in student unions in that period of time in the 1970s. And the university where I was attending was University College Galway, and we decided, no, we won't do this in the university. We will actually, what we will do is we will do it in the city, because in Galway there was no family planning clinic, and we decided instead of doing just something in the university, we would participate in setting up a family planning clinic in the city. And we decided, yeah, we will donate some money now to this. So the student council took a decision to donate the money, and within days, the signatures were collected around the campus, the big general meeting was called of the entire student body, and a majority decided to reverse the decision. And it taught me a lesson that the opposition to change wasn't entirely confined to people living in remote rural areas or whatever, that even then in the 1970s, young people at university weren't entirely agreeable with some of this social change. Meanwhile, the attempts were being made to change the law. Mary Robinson, as I said, introduced the first bill in 1971 to legalize contraception. And when she introduced it in the Senate, she could get only two other senators out of a total membership of 60, only two other senators who would support her bill on that occasion, and of course it was defeated. She took the case ultimately to the European Court of Human Rights, the case of a woman called Mrs. McGee, and that case was won in 1975. So now the government, now the legislature was going to have to legislate. So a new bill is introduced, but it was defeated because the then Prime Minister and a number of the members of his government, including I think the Education Minister and the Justice Minister, voted, and of course a number of other parliamentarians voted against it, and that was defeated. So it was slow getting this done. And in 1979, the then Minister for Health introduced a much more restrictive bill on legalising contraceptives, which he called an Irish solution to an Irish problem. And under that bill, to get contraceptives, you first of all, you had to be married, you went to your doctor, you persuaded your doctor that you needed the contraceptives for bona fide purposes of family planning, as opposed to, I presume, pleasure. He then issued you with a medical prescription, same as he would for any medicine, and you go to your pharmacy and you buy your packet of condoms. And that really wasn't changed until 1985, when the requirement to go to the doctor and all the prescription and so on, that was lifted, and then 1993, when the availability of contraceptives became generally available in the country. So that was a long battle, which ended in 1993. Divorce was banned by the 1937 Constitution. That could only be changed by a referendum, because you can only change the Constitution in Ireland by a referendum of the people. Things were looking good in the 1980s. The opinion polls were telling us that there was about a 2-to-1 majority in favour of introducing, lifting the ban on divorce. So in 1986, the government decided it would hold a referendum. And I remember, even though the opinion polls were saying, yep, it's going to be passed by 2-to-1, I remember the first inkling that I got that maybe it wasn't going to be quite as easy as that. The constituency where I was politically active was one of the more liberal constituencies in the country. We called our first public meeting on the campaign. I remember we invited Mary Robinson to speak at it, and she came, she was at the meeting. We expected several hundred, and there were 50. And most of them were the same political party activists and so on that you'd get for pretty well any cause at the time. So it didn't take off. And throughout the campaign, issues began to arise. So if we get divorced, who gets custody of the children? And we said, we'll deal with that in legislation. Pass the referendum first, we'll deal with that in legislation. If he dies, who's entitled to the widow's pension? Is it the first wife or the second wife? Who's entitled to inherit property? Who gets the farm, if he's a farmer? Who inherits the farm? Is it the first family or is it the second family? And we said, you know, we pass the legislation and we'll deal with all of this in legislation afterwards. And I think that was probably the big lesson we learned. The referendum was defeated. We started 2-to-1 in favor. It ended up being defeated 2-to-1 against. And the big lesson that we learned in that referendum was you never put the general principle first and ask people to worry about the details later. You've got to deal with the details first and then you settle the details. So when we prepared for our second referendum on divorce, which took place 10 years later, we decided that we were going to have everything in place. Issues like custody of children, new social welfare legislation on pensions, issues around separation and what happens in cases of separation. And we put all of the legislation in place first, and then we went back to the people with the issue of the divorce as a second, an issue to be decided. I was on the government committee in the mid-90s, which put that referendum in 1996. Once again, we started out, opinion polls saying 2-1, it will be passed. By the time we were about a week out from polling day, and I remember the meeting of the government committee where we had private polling, and it told us that this referendum was likely to be lost also. We were likely to lose a second time. So we did a number of things to try and turn that around, including having a massive rally and inviting various celebrities to become part of the campaign in the final week, and we won it, but only just. We won it 50.28% for and 49.72% against. It was a really close call. And the form of divorce which it allowed is quite restrictive. For example, you have to be separated for 4 years before you can apply for a divorce. But it meant at least that we'd got that out of the Constitution. On the issue of LGBTI rights, this man is probably, just like Mary Robinson was the unspoken leader of the liberal agenda, this man is without doubt the leading campaigner for LGBTI rights in Ireland. His name is David Norris. Like Mary Robinson, he's also a senator, still is a senator, a member of our Senate. He took a case about his own situation, about the fact that as a gay man he was being discriminated against by the laws on LGBTI issues in Ireland, and he won that at the European Court of Human Rights in 1988. He's also incidentally a professor at Trinity College Dublin, and he is the leading Irish authority on James Joyce. Homosexual acts were criminal in Ireland until 1993. Probably the most famous case of somebody being successfully prosecuted was Oscar Wilde, albeit at the turn of the 1920th century. He was prosecuted, one of our leading poets, playwrights, was given a 2-year prison sentence. And in prison, he wrote one of his more famous poems, The Ballad of Reading Jail, in 1898. As I mentioned, Senator David Norris took his case to the European Court of Human Rights. That was in 1988, was the result of that. And following on from that, the homosexual acts were decriminalised in 1993. The issue of marriage and civil unions it arose obviously quite quickly, but it didn't become a campaigning issue until we were until we had really rounded the century. And then the LGBTI community were actively campaigning for marriage or civil unions. And there was a lot of debate within the LGBTI community about whether they should look for marriage or whether it should look for some form of civil unions. And the first attempt to introduce civil unions legislation didn't come until 2006. It was introduced by my own party, the Labour Party. And I remember at the time having discussions with campaigners for marriage, civil unions, and being pressed on why we were proposing civil unions rather than marriage. And the reason was that in our constitution, marriage is defined as a union between a man and a woman. Marriage would require a change in that constitution. That in turn would require a referendum. And I was mindful of the lesson that we had learned during the divorce, particularly the first divorce referendum, that unless you put the building blocks in place first, you risk losing the referendum. And that is why We said, no, we've got to put civil unions legislation in place first, and then we will put a referendum. So the civil unions legislation was eventually enacted in 2010. I was the leader of the Labour Party at that stage, and we were preparing for the 2011 general election. And we decided, in line with that commitment and those discussions that we had with campaigners, that we would include in our party manifesto for the 2011 general election a commitment that if we were elected to government, that we would hold a referendum on the issue of same-sex marriage. We got a very good result in the 2011 general election, but you know, we didn't become the largest party, and we ended up negotiating a coalition government with Fine Gael, which is a centre-right party in Ireland, an affiliate of the European People's Party. And when we were negotiating the programme for government, we could not get agreement that the referendum would be included in the programme for government. Now, to be fair, that government was put together at a time of the economic crisis. We were in the bailout. There was a huge atmosphere of economic crisis in the country at that time. It was done very quickly. So there were a lot of issues that didn't get into the programme for government, but this was one of them. What we did agree, however, was we had agreed that there would be what we called a constitutional convention, that we needed to look at a number of issues in our constitution which needed to be modernised. And we came up with this idea. It was an idea that the Labour Party had proposed, that we would set up a constitutional convention, that this convention would be composed of a distinguished public person who would chair it, and then one third of the members would be members of Parliament, but two thirds of the membership of this constitutional convention would be citizens, and they would be selected randomly from the entire population. And that convention would look at our constitution and look at issues in it. And we agreed in the programme for government that the issue of same-sex marriage would be addressed by the constitutional convention. I've seen this happen before. Difficult issues. How do you solve it? You kick it to touch. You set up a committee. You set up some kind of a group that looks at it. It looks at it for a long time. By the time it has reported and the report is considered, things have moved on and it never happens. So in 2012, because I didn't want this to happen with the issue of same-sex marriage, in 2012 I took an opportunity at a party event to make a speech in which I talked about a lot of things, but among them was this issue of same-sex marriage. And in the course of the speech I said that for me, same-sex marriage is the civil rights issue of this generation. It was a statement that drew a lot of fire. People said, you know, that's a bit exaggerated. It probably was. My purpose in making it was to make it clear that I was not going to allow the same-sex marriage issue to be simply warehoused in the constitutional convention, that I wanted it to happen. But I got a lot of criticism from it, some of it, in fact, from within my own party, by people who said, you know, we're in the middle of an economic crisis, and you know, people are out there and they're worried about their jobs and they're worried about, you know, their house being taken away from them and so on, and you're talking about same-sex marriage. There was a lot of criticism and controversy about it at the time. But as it happened, the Constitutional Convention did recommend that there should be a referendum. It made that recommendation 2013. 2014, the government agreed that we would hold the referendum. We decided there was an obvious opportunity to hold the referendum. That was in mid-2014. The European and local elections were due to take place then, so people were going to the polls anyway. But we made a conscious decision not to do it then because we didn't want it to get mixed up with the electoral debate. But secondly, we also, and again, this was drawing on the lesson of the divorce referendum, we wanted to put in place legislation dealing with children, dealing with adoption, dealing with family relationships and so on. And that period, 2014 to 2015, did all of that. The date was set then for the referendum, the 22nd of May 2015. And under our rules, the rules governing referenda in Ireland, the government itself cannot spend any money on advocating, cannot spend public money on advocating in a referendum, and any public money which is spent and any use of broadcasting media must be done on an absolutely equal basis between both sides of the argument. The campaign got underway. A group was established. It had been established for some time in preparation for this campaign called Marriage Equality, which brought together all of the different campaigning groups. They prepared a very broad-based campaign. They set up an organization in every constituency. They coordinated closely with political parties. Once again, the opinion polls were all in our favor. They were saying 70-30. I'd seen this happen before. My concern was that in the course of the campaign that we could lose that majority, or certainly lose a large part of it. And the other issue that I was concerned about, I remember at that time, was that while we were hearing from people that yes, they were fine with same-sex marriage, didn't bother them. Sure, somebody wants to get married. That's their business. But I wasn't sure that they would actually go out and positively vote for it. And it wasn't until we actually got to the actual campaigning stage, when we're out and we do a form of campaigning where campaign groups call to houses, stop people on the street, meet them in shopping centres. It's a very active, personally engaged form of campaigning. We talk about the issues. And it wasn't until we actually got to that stage of the campaign that I noticed two things that I thought were quite remarkable. The first was families. Now, a lot of the people who were opposing same-sex marriage had traditionally wrapped themselves in, the family values. And one of the things that I found was that this was about families. Because I started to meet people who started to say, my niece, and she has formed a relationship, and I want her to be happy. And I want the same rights for her as for every member of this family. I don't want any member of my family to be different, to feel excluded. And it was really, there was this, in a way we were conducting the debate, the kind of narrative in favor of the campaign was about the kind of society we were going to have. No. The people we were meeting, we're not talking about big social. They didn't see this in a big social thing. They didn't see it in terms of big concept of equality. They saw it very much within their family. No member of this family is going to be treated less favorably or is going to have less rights than any other member of this family. And what I saw happening was a discussion which was taking place within families about the issue, and families deciding collectively. And I'm not talking about the four people in the traditional nuclear family around the dinner table. I'm talking about the big nuclear Irish family. The children, the parents, the grandparents, the great-grandparents in some cases, and they were all going out to vote. Not because of any big theoretical idea about this, but because there was some member of their family or some member of their neighbor's family that they knew that this mattered to, and they did not want to see them treated unequally. The second issue that we discovered was the mobilization of young people, massive numbers of young people for whom this mattered initially. So when I said, the civil rights issue of this generation, I could not have anticipated the degree to which young people in particular mobilized, and interestingly, many of them who had emigrated, many of them short-term immigrants, came back to vote in the referendum. The turnout for 60% is very high for a referendum in Ireland, for reasons I'm happy to go into later, but it's a long story. But 60% is a high turnout, and the result was absolutely overwhelmingly in favour, 62% in favour, 38% no. As I said, the Marriage Equality campaign, they ran a great campaign. This is one of the videos which they ran.
Hi, I'd like to ask for Sinead's hand in marriage, please.
Sure, no problem.
Thanks.
Hi!
I'd like to ask for Sinead's hand in marriage, please.
Okay.
Thanks.
Hamilton.
Gemma. On Will Cadogan, Sinead, Rosa.
Ta.
Brilliant. Gemma, good. I'd like to ask for Sinead's hand in marriage. Hello. I'd like to ask for Sinead's hand in marriage, please. Can I ask for Sinead's hand in marriage, please?
Yeah.
Thanks.
Come on.
I'd like to ask for Sinead's hand in marriage.
Our one of the many campaign videos which were used. So why did this transition take place from, you know, very conservative, very Catholic country to liberal society, which we saw the result of on the 23rd of May? I've listed 9 reasons here why I think which contributed to it. The first was economic. Massive change in our economy from the late 50s, from being very poor, largely agrarian economy, to becoming later Celtic Tiger, one of the fastest growing economies in the world, urbanized society. The second was television. Our national television service was introduced in 1962, and for the first time, there was this discussion started about issues which had been really, were not discussed at all. And there was one show in particular called The Late Late Show, screened on a Saturday night, largely light entertainment, but the broadcaster, one of our great broadcasters, used to occasionally start a discussion about some social issue which was controversial. And that often led to the program being denounced the following Sunday morning from the pulpit by priests and bishops, and then on Monday, because our local authorities held their meetings on Monday, to the various councils around the country, county councils and city councils, passing motions, criticizing television service. Some of it happened by accident. There was one occasion when, you know, these type of programs where they do these kind of competitions or kind of games, and this was one, you know, about how well did you know your partner, how well did you know your husband, how well did you know your wife, and so they had this couple, and they asked him the question. They said, "On your wedding night, what color was your wife's nightdress?" And he gave the wrong answer. He said blue or pink or whatever. And so when it came to her turn, she says, "No, that's wrong. On my wedding night, I wasn't wearing a nightdress." And the following day, the Bishop of Clonfert erupted on his pulpit. And there were plenty of incidents like that. And it led eventually, one politician, whom I won't identify, now that I think of it, he famously said there was no sex in Ireland before television, which wasn't the most evidence-based statement ever made given the size of Irish families, but anyway, that was it. I think the big thing that happened was education. We had an education revolution, the late 60s, 1967, universal second level education, introduction of grants, 1968 for students going to third level education, massive expansion of third level education to a point where now about 70% of our school leavers go on to further or higher education. All of that, the economic, the education, the urbanization of the country, I think contributed to a decline in the influence of the church, and that accelerated really from the 1990s onwards as we began to find out more about the various sex abuse scandals and other abuses which were taking place in church-run institutions. Our membership of the European Union, 1973, I think made a contribution, because what it did was it redefined how we saw ourselves. Up to that point, in many ways, we saw ourselves as kind of a post-colonial, former British colony. A lot of our point of reference was Britain. 1973, membership of the European Union, we began to see ourselves, yes, as Irish, but as Europeans, and began to look to the European norm as something that we should identify with. The European Convention on Human Rights, and in particular the Court, Strasbourg, It played, as I've mentioned, a number of cases which went there, played a very important role. The achieving of peace in Northern Ireland, not because it achieved peace, but because the peace settlement was based on the acceptance that of different identities and of tolerance towards different identities. That, you know, people have a kind of a different tradition and a different background and a different point of view, but you respect that. And therefore, this culture and this idea of respect for different traditions and different beliefs became part of our thinking. The work, obviously, of the liberal agenda over the years that I've already described, and in particular the role of the women's movement, and no doubt campaigning and the political leadership which was shown by some in the course of the campaign. That's Ireland. This is the rest of the world. I think the 19 might be wrong. I think when I first used this map, I think it was 19. I think it might actually be up to 21 now. But somebody, I'm sure, can correct me. That's the number of countries where same-sex marriage is recognized, is legal. The countries which are navy, the dark colored ones, are the ones which are where same-sex marriage is available. The light blue, mainly Eastern Europe, Australia, some parts of Latin America, is where you have civil unions. The very light blue in that western part of Australia is what's called unregistered cohabitation, not quite civil unions. The grey areas is where same-sex unions are not recognised, and then after that, it gets a bit more difficult. The green areas, as you can see, mainly Russia, is where you have laws restricting freedom of expression or association associated with LGBTI rights. The areas which are yellow are areas where homosexuality is illegal, but not really, laws are not really enforced. The brown areas, and you can see quite a number of them in Africa, some Middle East, are areas where there are prison sentences for homosexuality. The red areas, where you have where prison sentences can be up to life in prison, and the really dark, the very strong dark areas, is where you have the death penalty for crimes which are related to homosexuality. At the United Nations, there's an absolute division on this issue. There are two resolutions which are open for signature, two statements which are open for signature. The one which is supporting LGBTI rights opened in 2011. The blue countries are the ones that have signed that. There are 96 countries that have signed the UN statement supporting LGBTI rights. There was a counter resolution or counter statement which was introduced around the same time. The Holy See actually was one of the states which was responsible for introducing it. And that is opposing LGBTI rights. And they're the ones which are in red. There are 54 of those at the moment. There were actually 57. It's dropping, happily. And then the grey, the ones in grey, including Russia, China, quite a number of African countries, India, where they have taken neither position. So following the referendum in Ireland, I think the implications were, firstly, I think at an international level, I think it was an act of solidarity with oppressed LGBTI people everywhere in the world. I think I felt that it would encourage others who were campaigning for gay rights and marriage to continue. It tells us that change is possible. Sometimes it can take a long time. In our case, it took an entire lifetime to get to that change. I think our experience is that social change like this is multidimensional. You can't just start with one issue. If we had started, let's say, in the late 60s, and said, right, we're going to campaign for gay marriage, and the other changes hadn't happened, or there weren't other campaigns and other opening up of our society, it wouldn't have happened. I think it shows the importance of campaigning over a prolonged period of time, and of course the necessity for courage, because it isn't always easy. Mary Robinson, for example, tells the story of when she started, when she first introduced her first bill on contraception, the abuse that she got, the criticism that she got, the abuse that sometimes her family were subjected to. It's not easy, and it requires a great deal of courage. The work is never finished, of course. In Ireland, we still have unfinished business. Abortion is illegal since the 1860s. It is available in the UK, which is where most Irish women who want to get an abortion go. In 1983, through a campaign which was largely funded by mainly American fundamentalist groups, there was an amendment made to our constitution, which now makes it puts a constitutional ban largely on abortion. There have been various legal cases which have shown up anomalies. There was a case to the European Court of Human Rights. With some recent legislation, which is very minor in terms of what it opens up, and there is currently a campaign underway to repeal the Eighth Amendment and to take that provision out of our constitution to allow for legislation on abortion. That's the current, if you like, social agenda debate that's taking place in our country at the moment. I put this up here because, you know, having been associated with these issues and with campaigning on liberal issues over a lifetime, and looking at some of the things that are happening around us at the moment, and in particular I was listening to President Ignatieff's address on Tuesday evening about the open society and the discussion that he wants to open up about that. I think there are a number of issues that those of us who describe ourselves as liberals need to ask ourselves. We're great at going forward. We're great at, and you know, this is our experience, you know, we've won campaign and then the next one, and you know, now in Ireland our next campaign is repealing the Eighth Amendment on abortion. We're great at moving forward and seeking change. We're very bad when we have to travel in reverse gear. And that's where we are right now, because we are seeing, I think, a lot of the gains that were made, a lot of the gains I saw made in my own lifetime, coming under pressure now again. I've seen, for example, I worked in the trade union movement, I've seen the gains that were made by the labour movement, and I've seen the way in which those have been eroded in the face of globalisation. And a lot of that erosion is what is feeding a lot of what is described as populist politics at the moment. I think the gains that were made by the women's movement are coming under great pressure again. And if you look at countries where they turn into kind of fundamentalist type of roles, or you get domination of fundamentalist thinking in their running, the first victims very often are women and their rights. We're seeing some risks to the freedom of press and of expression. We're seeing a lot of it in recent political rhetoric. And as liberals, I think we've always been very, very, very uncomfortable with defending the status quo. You know, we always talk the language of change, but the language of change has changed, and the language of change now is not about good change in many cases. And I think that we have to, as liberals, I think we have to come to terms with what it means to defend what we have gained. Some of that defense, and they say, of course, best form of defense sometimes is attack. Some of that may well be around campaigning on issues that going forward. But I think the fundamental issue, I think, that we are going to be faced with over the next period of time is the defense of the liberal gains that we have made over that period of time. And I'll close by reminding you of the happy day on the 23rd of May 23rd of May 2015, and respond to any questions. Thank you very much.